I am Denis Siplakov. I work in data art, the position of solution architect. And today I want to talk about interesting topic: why engineers developing code way slower than client expects. There could be many answers to this question, actually. Well, the trivial answer is because client always expects us to be like faster, better, more advanced, whatever. But today I want to talk about a particular aspect of development process, which relates to SDLC process. And really sometimes team works like probably, I don't know, like 10 times slower than your gut feeling like tells you. Like, question is, what the hell? Like, why? There is a notion of a super programmer, a person who can write code 10 times faster than his colleagues or her colleagues. And this phenomena is quite old and pretty much well researched. And the answer is that technically, any developer could become a super programmer under some circumstances, when there is, you know, like right moment and all like surrounding ticks, and you can write code really, really fast. Comparing different projects and different companies, I can clearly say that there is a phenomena of super team which actually works like 5-10 times faster than similar teams. And the problem is that, not a problem, probably, the phenomenon is that basically this super team could consist of the same team members, can use the same project methodology, could have the same team size and team composition, but they just work faster. Same people, same methodology. Like, why it happens? There could be many reasons. There is when you estimate project duration, there is a well-known fact that team could work like probably 20% faster just because there is a right weather on the street, whatever. Like, and the opposite, like because it's bad weather, teams work slower. But one of the possible reasons is SDLC process. SDLC is software development lifecycle, how your software development process is built. And let's start from an example. Let's imagine the following story. Project manager asks developer to do the following task. Parse Excel file, extract list of inventory, whatever inventory list is, some, let's say, some items in the shop, whatever it could be. Check each inventory item price via some API call to some internal system, fill price column in the Excel, and return Excel file back. Like, quite simple. What are the steps? So we upload inventory list through some like basic web page, then we extract list of items, call some API of another system, fill price column, return updated Excel file back. How much would it take? Let's see. There is kind of rough breakdown structure, work breakdown structure. Assume we use Java, but I guess in any language it could be roughly the same. So let's say half an hour we need to decide on service and package names. Then probably like start Spring Boot initializer build service skeleton. Then like parse, create some simple file upload page using Apache Poi read document, parse Excel file, test parse method, find that something went wrong, search Stack Overflow, fix parse method. Finally, it works, call API endpoint, probably 30 more minutes, fill price column, again, 30 minutes, make file downloadable, git commit, git push, report task, explain how it works. Total probably 5 hours, like one work day, assuming you drink coffee in between and chat with your colleagues a little bit. So like fair task, pretty much relaxed schedule, like 5 hours. Is it like intense? Probably like on the spot, some developer could do this like way faster, maybe in 2 or 3 hours. Again, pretty much digestible, simple piece of work. Okay, that's look great. Let's assume we need to make the service part of company infrastructure. What does it mean? So it means that like the service should be, let's say, onboarded by IT department. It should fit like normal requirements, which you usually have in a big company. You should be able to support this service and so on and so forth. So what steps are missed in this story, assuming that we want to make this right? Let's walk step by step looking at SDLC workflow. So piece number one, requirements. Obviously want this service to work with a broader spectrum of Excel spreadsheets, not only one document. So we want to understand and we want to write down requirements somewhere, like what is possible format, what should happen if service is not able to find column in the right place, what are corner cases. Obviously, we need to validate this document somehow, and we need to write down this validation criteria. Obviously, we want to use some like business-driven development process, so we need to define some scenarios before we start development. Of course, we want to understand non-functional requirements, like what is acceptable latency, what is expected work, what is expected load on this service, should it be used by just one person or by like many, many IT departments? Should we add some authorization? Who should be able to call that API service? How system should behave in case if it's not able to find items through the API? Should it fail? Should it fail with some default value? And so on and so forth. Obviously, like service should follow corporate standards, including security and compliance. What are security requirements? Like, obviously, we want to use HTTPS, but what else? And of course, we want to prepare some well-grained inputs for developers. So not just one Excel file, but probably a set of different Excel files of different size, different composition, with some corner cases. Some of them are correct, some of them are not correct. And obviously, we want to define everything beforehand, before we start development. So when developer starts, he should have like clear list of requirements with all possible inputs that he or she should follow. This is a requirement stage. Planning. Of course, in our example above, there was just like ad hoc task, like, could you please code me this? Obviously, developers, they do not sit and wait for input from management. They have some process, normally Scrum. So they have sprints, sprints have backlog, and obviously they work on something on normal constant basis. So we cannot start development at any given point in time. So we need to plan our development activities. Nowadays, if we say plan, we assume some Jira ticket. So we need to create a Jira ticket. And obviously, before we start working on this Jira ticket, we need to like provide some estimate. How much would it take? Is it like 1 hour task or 1 day task or 1 month task? And we obviously need to create some draft estimate first, and then we need to create a refined development time estimate. In some teams, we probably want to play some sprint planning poker before we put task into a sprint backlog. And then we need to prioritize this task because like I assume we have probably dozens of tasks in our backlog and we cannot like do it them in random order. Then we need to assign this task to some sprint. Last but not least, we obviously like because we have external dependency, we need to align our team plan with team with roadmap of a team which works on that external API. We should check that external API is ready for our service before we start development, or at least we should align our roadmaps. This is about planning. So we cannot just start development at any given moment. We need to do some preparation. And yeah, last but not least, we need to write an implementation plan for this before we start development. We cannot just take black box tickets into our backlog. Okay, finally magic happened and we start development. Of course, like all old good times, when we develop something, we have just IDE, we write code, press that green button, and everything works. But nowadays, it's a little bit probably different. So we need to call another service. Should we call like production endpoint, or should we call some development environment, or should we have this service local copy of this service dockerized, and is it possible to, at all? So we need to set up our development environment with all possible dependencies. Nowadays we obviously want to dockerize our own service, so we cannot just like run it and say this is ready. No, like we need to package it for deployment, and nowadays packaging almost always means dockerization. And obviously we like want to have several environments, at least development stage. Obviously we want to have some integration environment, including like service access to another service with API tokens, maybe VPCs, maybe it will happen in cloud, again depending on how development process in our company works. Most likely we want to use company's Artifactory instead of public Maven registry, because we want like InfoSec department wants us to use well-proven dependencies, and we want to use Git flow or some other let's say predictable way to control changes in source control version. So we want to have branches, probably want to have pull requests. Again, nowadays nobody builds, builds production artifacts on his own laptop. So we want CI/CD, and we want to have separated build, test, run, and deploy stages. And most likely we want to build and test on each pull request, which is kind of nowadays as a best practice. And of course, we don't want to commit to our master branch some black box code. We want to have some formal pull request review process with at least two approvers. So we want to be sure that other team members will look at the code and approve it, and only approved code will be merged into master. And obviously, we want to have some, formal process which guarantees that code will be merged to master only after all organization threads are resolved and all CI/CD pipelines are green. Which basically brings us to quality assurance. Of course, we want to ensure some predictable, quality of our service. We want to ensure that our service meets requirements with a predictable quality, which basically means that we want quality assurance. You see, quality assurance doesn't sound like testing. There is no T in QA abbreviation, which basically means that when we want to assure quality, we want to have some strategy, some definition of quality, some steps how we achieve quality, and so on and so forth. We want to cover our code with unit tests. And when we talk about coverage, we want about 80% coverage. Sorry. And we obviously want to run unit tests on each pull request, but as usual, unit tests are not enough. We want to run end-to-end test again on each PR. So in order to make sure that you see that PR is green. And we want to have some stable environment for end-to-end tests. So we don't want to use some shared dev environment. We want to have some probably dedicated environment for each CI/CD pipeline. So we want to ensure that if CI/CD pipeline fails, then it fails. If it's green, then it's green. There is no some random circumstances which drives this green-red factor. And because we are using behavior-driven development, we want to align our QA strategy with BDD. So some scenarios which we define on requirement steps should be somehow checked on QA stage. Either it's like auto tests or manual tests, still we want to have this process more or less in a formal way. And last but not least, we most likely we want to have some more or less formal quality assurance acceptance gates. So it's not just like unit tests are green, then we want to deploy to production. Most likely we want to have something a little bit more formal. So at least QA team should provide some formal approval that, yeah, we believe this is fine. Let's assume we fit quality criteria, but when we talk about, let's say, at least medium-sized enterprise, there are like some notion of definition of done, some formal acceptance and deployment process, which normally means the following. So company normally wants to onboard services in a predictable way. At least we want to have some registry of our services. I guess you agree that we cannot have some unnumerated number of services run executed inside our environment. So, which basically means that we want to have the registry, some list of services which exist inside corporate environment. And once we talk about the registry, we obviously want to onboard services there in some, let's say, well-defined, predictable way. Normally, this includes some review from architectural committee, and obviously, we want to use only libraries with a proper license. Like nobody in a big enterprise wants to onboard service with GPL license and want to have some suitcase. And most likely, we want to pass some formal automatic scans, like Nexus IQ, Sneak, Sonar Cube, probably Fortify scan. Once we talk about a registry of services, most likely we want to have some deployment descriptor which describes at least service name, where service repository lives, which VM runs this service, probably something else, depending how our IT infrastructure works, but still service should be described by some formal or more or less formal descriptor. And obviously, we should have, we want to have documentation. So we would, don't want to have some black box service inside our corporate space. What else? Yeah, obviously, we want to have some performance tests. We want to pass some code review. Most likely, we want to have some runtime environment requirements, something like resource check, health check, resource definition. Because like when IT department start onboarding service, it mostly asks you, how much memory do you want for this service? How much disk space you want for this? Then we need to provide user training. We may want to pass some more or less formal certification. Then we need to deploy this service to production. And some usually this procedure differs from just from, let's say, dev and stage environment. So normally deployment to production is a little bit more formal. And after it's in production, we want to transition service to support team. Because normally developers don't want to support service like endlessly. Talking about support, company normally wants to know what to do in case if service deployment to production fails, like really what to do. Of course, they call developers, but what if it, developers is in vacation? Like what are next steps? Or what to do if service stop working on weekend near midnight, Saturday night after a corporate party when developer is on vacation, whatsoever. Like what are next steps? There should be some more or less clear instructions or at least some documentation for L1 and L2 support. And sorry. And what we should do if, like, for instance, CTO complains that service works, but Excel file is processed incorrectly, and it happened 4 weeks ago, but CTO still wants some answer, and we need, you know, to dig some log files or something in the past and find out what actually happened 4 weeks ago. And overall, like, how to understand that something is wrong before actually, like, everything crashes. Normally, this leads to some at least more or less formal support process and some notion of observability. So we need to be able to have like logs, some formal metrics, at least like CPU load, memory consumption, disk consumption, network traffic, IOPS. And in some advanced cases, we want to have some APM, some traces, which allows us to trace each endeavor request from the beginning to the end. You see on the right side, the process from end to end. So requirements, planning, input, documentation for tests, development process, setup, development itself, Git flow steps, quality assurance, QA automation, QA acceptance, definition of done, support, observability. And this box, well, actually it's drawn in a not in the right way, this arrow should lead to development. This development is actually that 5 hours. So that 5 hours sits here. And all boxes above is some extra. I guess you see the difference. we started from 5 hours of work in a pretty much relaxed manner. And finally, like suddenly we found ourselves in the middle of a huge story, which involves lots of steps beyond just development. It starts from requirement and adds up with support and observability. How much does it cost really? With all these steps in a full-scale enterprise environment, development of such a service could take probably 2 weeks plus of work. And if we gather all together, we'll see that like it's 5 hours versus, let's say, 80 hours, which you see is a ratio. For bigger chunks of work, ratio from development to, let's say, non-development task could be 1 to 4, but still, like, development could take only 25% of overall efforts. The worst case here, the worst thing here, is that all steps, really, all steps on this picture are reasonable. There is no something that was invented, like, intentionally to make development work slower, to make our things worse, and so on and so forth. So, like, all steps are freaking usable, reasonable. There is no redundant steps which were invented to make developers' lives worse. Where's the exit? Like, how to save our lives? Fortunately, some steps are optional and some steps are adjustable. Let's see how we can change this to something better. And at this slide, we actually see the answer why teams develop code like way slower than client expects. Because client expectations are inside this development box, inside this development 5 hours. And when we talk about onboarding of a service into a huge corporate environment, not always client understands all like related implications. how we can minimize it, how we can make this beast more predictable. Fortunately, actually, the trick is that if you look at development process, for instance, let's say how it was like 10 years ago, you can found that probably half of these boxes doesn't exist or were like way more lightweight. Each year brings us more and more good, useful, smart SDLC steps. But we need to understand that in most cases, these steps are not free, and we sacrifice time for quality or predictability or observability. So each and every step costs something. Roughly, it means that each year development process is slower and slower. But why some teams still move fast? What is like the secret sauce? Ingredient number one, probably. It's very obvious, but unfortunately, not each and every team follows this rule. Don't build it fragile. This is just very recent example. Client built the SDLC process in a way that all integration tests depends on Redis service, one single Redis service shared across all 20 teams, not containerized, just one static Redis installation. And this Redis goes down. And 20 teams were trying to figure out how to work, how to build and deploy their services for half a day. Like all 20 teams were blocked. So don't build process fragile. SDLC process should be as much autonomous as possible. So there is a good check for how long developer could develop code without interaction with like outer world, sitting in an airplane with his laptop. Ideal answer from a point where he takes Jira ticket to a point where he need to like merge it and test code in the integration branch. So again, like ideal SDL LDC, let's say ideal development process should work in an airplane. This is a good criteria. If you cannot work in airplane, then probably your process is not that autonomous and you can face some outages during your journey. Ingredient number one. Fortunately, we need all elements from the diagram above only in a very large development organization. If you have a really small, like not that small, you have a team of 20 developers and they sit in the same office, you eat pizza each Friday, drink beer, discuss architecture, and your product team drink beer with you, and your DevOps team drink beer with you, you'll probably can omit 80% of all steps above. All stakeholders need to understand that everything comes with a cost. So, you need to, let's say, design SDLC elements at organization level end-to-end. Let's imagine your compliance department comes with some requirement. And this requirement could cost you kind of $1 million per year. There should be end-to-end decision from which budget this $1 million should be taken, because all parties should understand that this requirement is a slowdown. And probably this requirement is a must. You cannot omit it. You must follow it. But there should be like shared understanding that, yeah, we applied some specific requirement and it costs us money and it costs budget. That's why development team works slower. Or probably we can mitigate this requirement by taking some other steps. But the key here is that SDLC process should be designed end-to-end and all parties should take participation in this discussion. There shouldn't be some like black box requirement when some infosec department throw in bomb into SDLC and they don't care about your speed. They just say, this is a requirement, we don't care. everything should be collaborative and all parties should understand implications, especially budget-wise. Another point, another way to mitigate this is reducing communication overhead. Nowadays, especially with remote work with coronavirus, people tend to follow, let's say, more formal processes. Let me give you an example. So you need to review PR, pull request. Basically, there are two polar points. You can, let's say, review it all together just on a call or just physically sitting in one meeting room and just walk through the code changes, discuss them, probably make changes on the spot right in that room, update pull request, merge it, you're done. It could take maybe 1 to 2 hours, probably even less in case of smaller pull request. Or you can follow some relatively formal process with comments, probably even some tickets, communication threads. And in this case, review could take, I don't know, like there is a real case, review of pull request could take up to, I don't know, a week and a half, for instance, instead of 1 hour. Obviously, this slows down development. Because if you created a pull request and then it takes you like week and a half to discuss it and merge it, you lose context, you start working on something else, like code quality is reduced. So the more formal your communication process is, the more overheads you have. So you always should take it in mind and try to keep it less formal if it's possible, of course. Formal mechanism of pull request comments is fine, but you always need to mind your environment. So if you're one team which sits in one office, you probably shouldn't go too formal. You probably should go the opposite side. You should, let's say, rely on less informal communications. If you sit in different continents, in different time zones, yeah, you need to be pretty formal. But again, this is overhead that you need to keep in mind and understand this, this overhead increase cost of development. Another ingredient is isolation of complexity. Literally, each element of DLC is potentially interconnected with each other. Like basically, which basically means that if you have 20 elements, this gives us that big number of possible combinations. So the way how we gather requirements could affect acceptance process. The way the Git flow we choose could affect deployment process. Deployment process could affect support process and so on and so forth. So the more elements we have, the more combinations we have. We should either try to reduce number of elements, or if it's not possible, if element is absolutely necessary, we can hide some complexity from, let's say, development team. So we cannot hide it completely. For instance, say like development team just develops code and don't care about deployment. No, this will lead to blur of responsibility. But we hide some set of elements and encapsulate complexity into some simple rules. For instance, let's assume we use Kubernetes for application deployment. If we ask development team to be that experienced with Kubernetes as, let's say, normal DevOps team is, it will take, I don't know, weeks to study Kubernetes and will lead to unnecessary spike of complexity. But we can probably give development team some several simple rules that they should follow in order to be develop, let's say, Kubernetes-compatible services. And the same we can do with other SDLC stages. For instance, with quality assurance, we can say, look, guys, we have set of auto tests. You should write unit tests, and all tests should be green. The quality assurance process itself could be very, very complex. But we can hide this complexity from development team and just isolate this between teams. The same actually for QA team. QA team is also under stress, but we can isolate complexity for QA team either. And the same with DevOps team, and the same with business analyst team. So we should build some, let's say, more or less formal, simple gates between different areas of SDLC process in order not to make this process, let's say, simple in a nutshell. And icing on the cake, probable future. If you look at this process, you'll see that, and if you count tools that are involved in here, you'll probably see that potential set could include Postman, Jira, Confluence, integrated development environment, Docker, Git, Selenium, Git Actions, Terraform, Snyk, SonarQube, NexusIQ, Elk, Zabbix, and as usual, lots of Excel spreadsheets that team need to fill in order to onboard service into corporate environment. Like 10 plus tools. Sometimes you could expect 20 tools. And obviously, these tools are developed by different companies. Most likely, you need to have lots of, let's say, glue code or glue procedures, glue workflows between these tools in order to make this process work all together. Like, I saw like some cases when onboarding an explanation of all tool chain could take several weeks. Just providing access to all tools and explaining how one tool should be used in conjunction with another tool and so on and so forth. And currently, I don't have good solution how to avoid this. Basically, I don't have idea how to build a SDLC process, including all possible tools in a seamless, easy way without lots of glue between these tools. Unfortunately, of course, if you talk about enterprise environment, but there is like a sign of a possible future solution in a way of, let's say, low code workflow tools. And as an example of these tools, of such a tool, we have some, we have AWS Amplify, which for simple, small applications simplifies development process a lot. So you can just like throw in this tool and you have like streamlined flow from repository to deployment. And it's really awesome. Unfortunately, this tool from my standpoint, from my opinion, is not ready for bigger projects, but it's just a first step. Maybe in a year or two or 3 years, we'll have some, let's say, bigger tool which allow us to have seamless SDLC process just in one click in cloud. Another possible solution, nowadays clouds provides you with kind of CDK, like toolkit, which allows you to build some integrated flow using some script language like Groovy. So probably at some point we'll be able to build some something like Gradle builds with DSL, when we can be able to define a flow from end-to-end tests to support and observability in a one single digestible script. But again, this is more a future rather than what we have currently, but I see some movement in this area. So let's see where it will lead us in a year or two. Basically, that's it.